This video is going to focus on what happens when you move an instruction before a branch. Okay, so in previous videos we've talked about smart scheduling, and we've seen that we want to move instructions up or down to try and hide stall cycles. Okay, now you know branches are very common, so very often when you're doing this reordering you might end up moving an instruction before a branch. If you disallow that, then that puts a lot of constraints on the compiler and you may not be able to come up with the best schedule, right? So we really want to move instructions far enough up or down, and by moving it far enough you might be crossing some branch boundaries. Okay, so let's see what complications that could lead to and how you might be able to overcome those problems. Okay, so here's an example, right? So I have a store, I have a branch, and then the branch goes, you know, one of two ways, and there's a load on one of the ways. Okay, let's say the load is along the then part. Now this load, let's say, is known to be a long latency instruction, right? Perhaps it often results in a cache miss. Okay, so you want to get its work done as early as possible so that when you need the result of the load, the value is already available. Okay, so let's say that this load is producing a result in R1 and the address is sitting in R2. Okay, and I want to move this instruction ahead, so the new code becomes something like this. Load into R1 from this address, do the store, do the branch, then go one of these two ways. Okay, now you know it's possible that you know what this load is doing is loading some value from some array element, and you know that array goes from x1 to 100, let's say. Okay, if by some chance this load was getting something from array element x101 and you moved it up over here, then this load is going to result in a segmentation fault and the program is going to crash. Okay, now it's possible that the original program would not have crashed. Maybe what the branch is doing is checking to see, you know, if this access is in bounds. And if it's in bounds, then you go ahead and perform the load. Otherwise, you go along the other path. Okay, so the original program was written correctly. You were making sure that there was no segmentation fault. But if you move the load up, the segmentation fault is going to happen right here, and the program is going to terminate. Right, and so even though the programmer wrote the code correctly, the compiler is doing an optimization which is going to break the program. Okay, so obviously the compiler is not going to do this, right? Compilers are written in a conservative manner so that you don't violate correctness. Okay, so the compiler would then choose not to do this, and as I said, you're putting all these constraints on the compiler, and so you probably cannot come up with the most optimal schedule. Okay, so instead, you know, let's see what we can do to allow the compiler to do this and yet not violate correctness. Okay, so one option is to convert this load into a special load which is marked as a speculative load. It's marked as a load.s. Okay, and if the program does cause an exception, instead of terminating the program, all you do is put a special value into register R1. So there's a special value put in there which says that this instruction actually raised an exception which should cause the program to fail, but since this is marked as a load.s, I'm not going to fail at this point, but I'll take note of this exception and I'll store that that exception condition inside R1. Okay, so later when you come down over here, which is where the load should have executed, I'll put a special instruction called a check. This is also called a sentinel instruction. And this check instruction is going to inspect the contents of R1. And if it finds that special exception condition, it's going to say that, well, the load didn't succeed, and I have to jump to some recovery code, which perhaps will re-execute the load, see if it's really supposed to fail. And if it fails, at that point, you're supposed to make the program crash. Okay, so this makes sure that if you do go along the opposite path, the program does not terminate, right? You'd put some wrong result in R1, but you're never even going to check that value in R1. Okay, so you know this is a fairly easy method to make sure that the compiler can move instructions above a branch. And in the next video, I will look at a similar problem, but that focuses on memory dependencies.